Appendix. I have deemed it necessary to include in this book a section citing some of the greatest thinkers of the English Reformation. The topic of the papal Antichrist arose several times in the course of this writing, yet I am aware that this book lacks a meticulous, systematic teaching on the subject. The topic of the papacy and the Antichrist is exhaustively covered in my book, The Present Reign of Jesus Christ. A Berean student of history should have no problem researching this consistent historical theology, more often universally agreed upon than not in the Protestant Church. Today, it is hard for us to comprehend this. We have the futurists to thank for that. The historical school has so often been overlooked and its voluminous teaching misrepresented that any man or woman who dares to proclaim it as the true interpretation faces the same intolerant and indignant spirits that these mighty English reformers faced. We must search far and wide to find teachers today who possess the capacity and courage of the Reformation fathers. I'm not talking about revelation knowledge, but rather intestinal fortitude and the ability to wield a razor-sharp sword of truth, no matter what the cost. Tyndale, martyred 1536. Now, though the Bishop of Rome and his sects give Christ these names, Jesus, a Savior, Christus, King appointed over all men, Emmanuel, God with us, Sanctus, that is, holy, that halloweth, sanctifieth, and blesseth all nations, yet in that they rob him of the effect, and take the significations of his names unto themselves, and make of him but a hypocrite, as they themselves be. They be the right Antichrist, and deny both the Father and the Son, for they deny the witness the Father bare unto the Son, and deprive the Son of all the power and glory that his Father gave him. Cranmer, Archbishop of Canterbury, 1533, martyred, 1555. But the Romish Antichrist, to deface this great benefit of Christ, hath taught that his sacrifice upon the cross is not sufficient hereunto, without another sacrifice devised by him, and made by the priest, or else without indulgences, beads, pardons, pilgrimages, and such pelfrey, to supply Christ's imperfection, and that Christian people cannot apply to themselves the benefits of Christ's passion, but that the same is in the distribution of the Bishop of Rome, or else that by Christ we have no full remission, but be delivered only from sin, and yet remaineth the temporal pain and purgatory due for the same, to be remitted after this life by the Romish Antichrist and his ministers, who take upon them to do for us that thing which Christ either would not or could not do. O heinous blasphemy and most detestable injury against Christ! O wicked abomination in the temple of God! O pride intolerable of Antichrist and most manifest token of the son of perdition, extolling himself above God and with Lucifer exalting his seat and power above the throne of God. Latimer, Bishop of Worcester, 1535 to 1539, martyred, 1555. Judge not before the Lord's coming, and this we learn to know Antichrist, which doth elevate himself in the church, and judgeth at his pleasure before the time. His canonizations and judging of men before the Lord's judgment be a manifest token of Antichrist. How can he know saints? He knoweth not his own heart. Ridley, Bishop of Rochester, 1547, and of London, 1550 to 1553, martyred, 1555. The see of Rome is the seat of Satan, and the bishop of the same that maintaineth the abominations thereof is Antichrist himself indeed. And for the same causes, this see at this day is the same which St. John calleth in his revelation Babylon, or the whore of Babylon, and spiritual Sodom in Egypt, the mother of fornications and of the abominations upon the earth. Hooper, Bishop of Gloucester, 1551 to 1554, martyred, 1555. If godly Moses and his brother Aaron never acclaimed this title to be God's vicar and lieutenant in the earth, Doubtless, it is a foul and detestable arrogancy that these ungodly bishops of Rome attribute unto themselves to be the heads of Christ's church. Because God hath given this light unto my countrymen, which be all persuaded, or else God send them to be persuaded, that neither the bishop of Rome nor none other is Christ's vicar upon the earth. It is no need to use any long or copious oration. It is so plain that it needeth no probation. The very properties of Antichrist, I mean of Christ's great and principal enemy, is so openly known to all men that are not blinded with the smoke of Rome, that they know him to be the beast that John describeth in the Apocalypse. Philpot, Archdeacon of Winchester, martyred, 1555. I doubt not, but you have already cast the price of this your building of the house of God, that it is like to be no less than your life. For I believe, as Paul saith, that God hath appointed us in these latter days like sheep to the slaughter. Antichrist is come again, and he must make a feast to Beelzebub, his father, of many Christian bodies, for the restoring again of his kingdom. Let us watch and pray that the same day may not find us unready. Bradford, Prebendary of St. Paul's, martyred, 1555. This word of God, written by the prophets and apostles, left and contained in the canonical books of the Holy Bible, I do believe to contain plentifully all things necessary to salvation, so that nothing as necessary to salvation ought to be added thereto. In testimony of this faith, I render and give my life, being condemned as well for not acknowledging the Antichrist of Rome to be Christ's vicar general and supreme head of his Catholic and universal church here and elsewhere upon earth. As for denying the horrible and idolatrous doctrine of transubstantiation and Christ's real, corporal, and carnal presence in his supper under the forms and accidents of bread and wine. Homilies of the Church of England, authorized, 1563. Our Savior Christ and St. Peter teacheth, most earnestly and agreeably, obedience to kings as to the chief and supreme rulers in this world, next under God. But the Bishop of Rome teacheth that they that are under him are free from all burdens and changes of the commonwealth, and obedience towards their prince, most clearly against Christ's doctrine and St. Peter's. He ought therefore rather to be called Antichrist, and the successor of the scribes and Pharisees, than Christ's vicar or St. Peter's successor, seeing that not only in this point, but also in other weighty matters of Christian religion, in matters of remission and forgiveness of sins and of salvation, he teacheth so directly against both St. Peter and against our Savior Christ, who not only taught obedience to kings, but also practiced obedience in their conversation and living, for we read that they both paid tribute to the king. Neither ought miracles to persuade us to do contrary to God's word, for the scriptures have for a warning hereof foreshowed that the kingdom of Antichrist shall be mighty in miracles and wonders, to the strong illusion of all the reprobate. But in this they pass the folly and wickedness of the Gentiles, that they honor and worship the relics and bones of our saints, which prove that they be mortal men and dead, and therefore no gods to be worshipped, which the Gentiles would never confess of their gods for very shame. The true church hath always three notes or marks whereby it is known: pure and sound doctrine, the sacraments ministered according to Christ's holy institution, and the right use of ecclesiastical discipline. Now, if ye will compare this with the Church of Rome, not as it was in the beginning, but as it is presently, and hath been for the space of 900 years and odd, you shall well perceive the state thereof to be so far wide from the nature of the true church that nothing can be more. The popes, in not hearing Christ's voice as they ought to do, but preferring their own decrees before the express word of God, do plainly argue to the world that they are not of Christ, nor yet possessed with his spirit. They are worthily accounted among the number of false prophets and false Christs, which deceive the world a long while, The Lord of heaven and earth, defend us from their tyranny and pride, that they never enter into his vineyard again. And of his great mercy, so work in all men's hearts by the mighty power of the Holy Ghost, that the comfortable gospel of his Son Christ may be truly preached, truly received, and truly followed in all places, to the beating down of sin, death, the Pope, the devil, and all the kingdom of Antichrist. Jewell, Bishop of Salisbury, 1559 to 1571. Such shall be the power and authority of Antichrist, so shall he possess the consciences of the people. So shall he sit as an idol in their hearts. So shall he stand in the place of God and show himself that he is God. The people shall receive his doctrine and believe his word. They shall fall down before him and worship him. They shall say, who is like unto the beast? What creature is so beautiful as he? They shall honor him as God. But what is he which hath been called by the name of God? Who hath been so wicked? Who hath ever so much forgotten himself? In what place hath he dwelt? Or what hath he been? Here, methinketh, I see the secret motions of your heart. You look that I should name the Bishop of Rome, that it is he which hath suffered himself to be called by the name of God. I will not tell you in mine own words. Unless the bishop himself so speak, I will not tell you. Then let us see what he hath written of himself, and what he hath suffered others to write. Pope Nicholas saith, it is well known that the Pope of the godly Prince Constantine was called God. In the extravagance it is set down, Dominus Deus Noster Papa, our Lord God the Pope. Mark these words, our Lord God the Pope. In them the Pope is called Lord and is called God. O merciful Lord God, which from thy heavens beholdest this vanity, how great is thy mercy in suffering this. I devise not this. His own books, his own doctors, his own decrees and decretals speak it and set it down. Credir Dominum Deum Nostrum Papam non posus statur prout statuit hereticum censurator. To believe that our Lord God the Pope might not decree as he decreed, it were a matter of heresy. It is so written there. He hath heard it. He hath seen it. He knoweth it is so. Yet he suffereth it to go abroad, and thereby suffereth himself to be called God. He hath burnt many saints of God and holy men for no other cause but for the profession of the gospel. He hath in many places burnt the Holy Bible and such books as teach nothing but godliness. Where did he ever burn? What speak I of burning? Where may it appear that ever he controlled any for so writing or called in such speeches? Many places of the Holy Scripture spoken of Antichrist seemed in old times to be dark and doubtful, for that as then it appeared not under what state and government they might be applied, but now by the doctrine and practice of the Church of Rome, to them that have eyes to see, they are as clear and as open as the sun. We are not the ministers of Antichrist, Master Harding, but the witnesses of Christ. He is Antichrist, as St. Paul showeth you, that sitteth in the temple of God, and advanceth himself above all that is called God. And to speak more particularly of the matter, by St. Gregory's judgment he is Antichrist, or the forerunner of Antichrist, that calleth himself the universal bishop, and vaunteth himself as the king of pride, and hath an army of priests prepared for him, and setteth himself as Lucifer above all his brethren. These be the words of St. Gregory. By such colors he blazed out the kingdom of Antichrist. Of him Cardinal Franciscus Zabarella saith thus, the Pope doth what him listeth, yea, though it be unlawful, and is more than a god. This is Antichrist, Master Harding, by the judgment of the wise and godly and the supporters of him, whosoever and wheresoever they be, are the ministers of Antichrist. Becken, chaplain to Archbishop Cranmer and prebendary of Canterbury, died 1567. Antichrist hath set up diverse sacrifices for sins, but namely that vile and abominable sacrifice of the Mass, which he calleth a propitiatory, expiatory, and satisfactory sacrifice for the sins of the quick and the dead, necessary ad salutum. This sacrifice he braggeth to be of like dignity and of equal price with that sacrifice which Christ the high and everlasting bishop offered on the altar of the cross, yea, to be the very same, again, that he and his chaplains in that sacrifice of that idolatrous mass do daily offer up the Son of God to the Father of heaven for the daily sins of the people. Antichrist, moreover, is not ashamed to say that Christ, by the sacrifice of his death done on the altar of the cross, did only put away original sin, but he and his shavelings, by the sacrifice of their mass, putteth away all other sins at all times, both actual, venial, mortal, etc. Sandys, Bishop of Worcester, 1559, of London, 1570, and Archbishop of York, 1576 to 1588. Christ proposeth his heavenly treasures, remission of sins, justification, sanctification, mercy, grace, and salvation freely. He that sitteth in the temple of God, and termeth himself Christ's vicar, doth in like sort offer unto the people bread, water, wine, milk, pardon of sins, grace, mercy, and eternal life, but not freely. He is a merchant. He giveth nothing, and this is nothing which he selleth. For although he makes large promises to the buyer, he selleth that which he hath not to deliver. Thus you see a manifest difference between Christ and Antichrist. Fulk, Master of Pembroke Hall, Cambridge, 1557 to 1589. The second argument is that Antichrist is called the adversary, and therefore is the greatest enemy of Christ, denying Jesus Christ to be God and man, or to be our mediator. I answer, the Pope doth so, denying the office of Christ, although, with the devils, he confess in words Jesus to be the Holy One of God, and to be Christ the Son of God. His divinity, the Pope, denieth by denying his only power in saving, his wisdom and his word to be only sufficient, his goodness and the virtue of his death to take away both pain and guilt of sin, which he arrogateth to himself by his blasphemous pardons. Christ's humanity he denieth by his transubstantiation. His mediation, in which he is principally Christ, he denieth by so many means of salvation as he maketh beside Christ, to wit, man's merits, ceremonies invented by man, pardons, a new sacrifice of the Mass, etc. The city with seven hills is still the see of Antichrist described by St. John. The see being found, it is easy to find the person by St. Paul's description, and this note especially, that excludeth the heathen tyrants. He shall sit in the temple of God. Which when we see to be fulfilled in the Pope, although none of the eldest fathers could see it, because it was performed after their death, we nothing doubt to say and affirm still that the Pope is that man of sin and son of perdition, the adversary that lifteth up himself above all that is called God, and shall be destroyed by the spirit of the Lord's mouth and by the glory of his coming. Whitgift, Archbishop of Canterbury, 1583 to 1604. For anything to be a note of Antichrist is not in the nature of any creature in itself, for to that end nothing was made of God, but it hangeth altogether of consenting to Antichrist's religion and the professing thereof. The which consent and profession being changed into the consent and profession of Christianity, there can stick in the things themselves no note or mark of Antichrist's religion. The use of bells was a mark of anti-Christianity in our churches, when the people by them were called to masses, and when they were rung against tempests. Now they are a token of Christianity, when the people by them are gathered together to the gospel of Christ and other holy actions. Hooker, Master of the Temple, died 1600. I permit it to your wise considerations, whether it be more likely that as frenzy, though itself take away the use of reason, doth notwithstanding prove them reasonable creatures which have it, because none can be frantic but they, so anti-Christianity, being the bane and plain overthrow of Christianity, may nevertheless argue the church wherein Antichrist sitteth to be Christian. Neither have I ever hitherto heard or read any one word alleged of force to warrant that God doth otherwise than so as hath been in the two next questions before declared bind himself to keep his elect from worshipping the beast and from receiving his mark in their foreheads, but he hath preserved and will preserve them from receiving any deadly wound at the hands of the man of sin, whose deceit hath prevailed over none to death, but only such as never loved the truth, such as took pleasure in unrighteousness. They in all ages whose hearts have delighted in the principal truth, and whose souls have thirsted after righteousness, if they receive the mark of error, the mercy of God, even erring, and dangerously erring, might save them. If they receive the mark of heresy, the same mercy did, I doubt not, convert them. Translators of the Authorized English Version of the Bible, A.D. 1611. Their contentment every day increaseth and taketh strength when they observe that the zeal of your majesty toward the house of God doth not slack or go backward, but is more and more kindled, manifesting itself abroad in the farthest parts of Christendom by writing in defense of the truth, which hath given such a blow unto that man of sin as will not be healed. Articles of the Irish Church, agreed on by the archbishops, bishops, and the rest of the clergy of Ireland, in convocation at Dublin, A.D. 1615. The Bishop of Rome is so far from being the supreme head of the universal Church of Christ that his works and doctrine do plainly discover him to be that man of sin foretold in the Holy Scriptures, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall abolish with the brightness of his coming. And Papa, sit Antichristus, I hold affirmative.